My name's Victoria Stambaugh. I'm 27 years old. I've been doing Taekwondo for 20 years now. I started at the age of 8 years old, and I qualify for the Olympics in 2020 of March, and I'm preparing right now for Tokyo 2021. I was born in Pasadena, Texas. I grew up in Pasadena as well. My dad was a professional boxer, and so I started Taekwondo at the age of 8, but I did judo and karate at the age of 7. And then my cousins were doing Taekwondo, and my dad also knew the owner of the Taekwondo gym that they were going to, and so he decided, you know, to put me and my brother in, and we did it, and they loved it. My parents loved it, and yeah, I just went from there. But as I grew into the sport and really started to find a passion for it, I started watching Jackie Chan films and stuff, and I was like, wow, I want to be Jackie Chan when I grow up. So Jackie Chan, Jet Li, they were my inspirations growing up. When I was an orange belt, the coach who founded me invited me to go try out for the Olympic sparring team that they had at the school. I ended up going to try out for the team, and so I started Olympic sparring at 8 years old. That first day, they made sure to put like their black belt and red belts against me. I was an orange belt, and to make me cry. But I think since I was little, I was very competitive. When I cry or I'm knocked down, I always want to come back and just prove to them and myself that, no, I'm going to be better than you, and no, I'm going to come back, and I'm going to be fine, and I'm going to dominate, and whatever this is that y'all got going on, no, I'm going to be good. I'm going to be really good, and I'm not going to cry again. When I was a kid, I was dominating most of the tournaments that I would go. I'd get gold, or I did really well. When I was 13, I won both USA Nationals and AU Nationals, both back-to-back, I think within the same week or 2 weeks. And so when I was 14, I made the AU national team and also the USA national team for juniors, and I went to junior world championships in Izmir, Turkey, and some other opens internationally. I think the school that I went to was a huge reason actually of why I was able to be successful in Taekwondo at a young age, because they allowed me to travel and they supported me going off and doing all these trips. Those experiences opened up my eyes at such a young age, being able to compete with different countries, and not only compete but make friends with people from different countries and learn different cultures and experience that, and be on a team with doctors and therapists and things like that. I was just like, wow. I really fell in love with that, and I was like, this is what I want to do. But it wasn't until when I was 15 when I made the USA national team. That was when I was like, this is now my goal is to qualify for the Olympics. So at 15 years old, I was the youngest one to make USA national team. And then from then, I was just like, now I'm going for London 2012. I was 16 years old when I had my first ACL surgery/tear. I tore my ACL in my right knee, and it was my first surgery ever. So I was really nervous about it, and I didn't know what to expect at all. I never knew like what an ACL surgery was, and I didn't know what that meant for me as my career moving forward, recovery-wise. I didn't know anything. I was 16 years old, and it was a really hard experience for me. The surgery didn't go well at all, and it was just a horrible experience. And the next 6 months after that, I felt kind of hopeless, because I always felt that my knee wasn't the way it should be. My knee keeps shifting out of place. For me, I was just like, when am I gonna feel like normal again? Like, when am I gonna feel like confident in my body and confident in my knee? From then, 2010, up until 2012, I was competing and training basically with a failed ACL, you can say. 2012 comes. I wasn't in the best state, I would say, to qualify for the Olympics, and there were politics involved. I went from fighting for Team USA in 2010, and then in 2011, transitioning to compete for Puerto Rico. And I had an invitation from the president of the Taekwondo Federation for Puerto Rico to fight for Puerto Rico and potentially make their Olympic team for London 2012. And Puerto Rico told me that, you know, we don't have our Olympic team finalized, or we don't know what weight categories we're gonna take. They knew that I had family from Puerto Rico, and so they invited me to go fight for Puerto Rico. And from there, I was doing very well, but still dealing with the knee problem that I had from 2010. They ended up not taking me for the Olympic qualifiers for London. Shortly after that, I actually went to the Pan Am Championships for Puerto Rico. That was a tournament that changed everything for me. It was October 2012. I competed at the Pan Am Championships, and that was the tournament I tore my other ACL and meniscus. And it felt even worse than the first time I tore my ACL in my right knee, and that was because of the meniscus. And as soon as it happened, I went down, you know, I started crying. There's photos of me on the mat crying, and my coaches taking me away back to the holding area. I couldn't walk, and I was just devastated. And so when I went back home to Houston right after that, I knew I wasn't gonna use the same doctor that I used for my first knee surgery.
The ACL, or the anterior cruciate ligament, is basically the main stabilizing ligament of the knee. When you cut hard off your knee, when you jump and land on your knee, when you do those things, and when it tears, your knee sort of goes out of place when you do those things. And so the instability that comes from it usually keeps you from competing and tears up a lot of other things in your knee if you allow that sort of going in and out of place to continue to happen. You know, when you take care of elite level athletes, people like Victoria, you know, a lot of them really put their bodies through things that their bodies aren't designed to do, no matter how hard they train or how good a shape they're in from that standpoint. And I definitely think Victoria is one of those. She has more grit and resilience than anybody I've ever met.
And so when I went to go see Dr. Lowe, and he was amazing, like, it was just great. He checked out my left knee. He's checked out, he's like, yep, this is the ACL. And then he checked out the meniscus, and he said that it was a pretty bad meniscus tear, almost to the point where if it was any worse, that it might not have been savable at that time. And then right before he leaves the room, I'm like, wait, can you actually check my right knee? And I look at my parents, and so he checks my right knee. And then he starts moving it. This right knee is worse than this left knee that you just tore. My face, I was just like so happy. I know it sounds crazy, but I was so happy. And I looked at my parents, I'm like, thank you. Like, that's what I feel, yes. Like, I'm not going crazy. I knew I wasn't crazy. I knew there was something wrong with it. So he told me right then and there, he's like, we're gonna have to have ACL surgery on your other knee. We're gonna have to do both knee surgeries for ACL. I was so ready. Like, I was so ready to do it. And so in 2012, you know, he does my left ACL meniscus. I had to let that heal for a couple months. And then 2013, I had my last ACL surgery where he put in the ACL for the right knee. And at that point, my left knee was coming along well in the recovery. And from then on, it was like, go time, okay, it's recovery time. A month or two later, I was ready to go. I was ready to just start training. My therapist really helped me in my recovery process, getting back into competing. They helped me mentally, you know, giving me the encouragement and the confidence. And Dr. Lowe as well, like, he gave me that confidence.
The maturation process is basically a year or longer, okay? And the return to play, if you can get them to go reasonably slow, they're gonna start pushing around 6 months to be back doing anything and everything, you know, they wanna do. So we do have this window that, you know, most athletes are back competing, but yet at the same time, we still have ongoing remodeling and healing of these tissues. But if you keep somebody out of their sport for 18 months, they're probably never going back to it at a very high level too. So it's a balancing act. You do expect them to return to their previous level and everything they could do before. And that might sound a little arrogant, but these people make things look easy. Acceleration-wise, strength-wise, you know, you would expect everybody to get back to where they were before. And with all the sports science stuff now, we know who they were before, and we want to get them there before we even release them back to play at the pro levels, because they can't compete if they're not who they were before.
The confidence is key, and if you're confident and the doctor's confident, and your therapist's confident, it helps the athlete, because we trust them. You know, we trust the medical staff that deals with our injuries. Sure enough, in 2014, I make Puerto Rican national team again, and I do it in style and I do it well, and people were very surprised and they're like, yeah, she's back. The end of 2014, I win silver at the Central American Caribbean Games, and I got the highest medal at the Caribbean Games for Puerto Rico in Taekwondo. I qualified for the Pan Am Games that year. It was in Toronto, 2015. And so I went on 2015, and they made the decision to choose me to qualify for Puerto Rico at the 2016 Olympic qualifiers for Rio. Fight day comes. I win the first two fights, so I had one more fight to win to qualify for the Rio Olympic Games. The girl that I was gonna fight, I fought her 2 weeks before in like a scrimmage match kind of thing, and I beat her. I had the thinking of like, I had that power to control whether I'm gonna win or lose to this girl, and I was very confident going in that I was gonna beat her. Now, while the fight's going on, I was doing very well. I was dominating. She gets this super lucky shot right where the neck is, and they give her the face shot. And I keep going. I hit her in the face throughout the fight at least three times. It wasn't scoring, and then she was holding me a lot. And you can't do that in Taekwondo. Those are called kyungos at the time, which is half a point off. Just didn't give her enough kyungos, I feel, for her holding me. And long story short, I ended up losing. I lost the fight, and I was just absolutely shocked. What just happened? Like, in my mind, I was just like, I went to the ref. I remember going to the ref. I'm like, what just happened? I was like, why? And then she looked at me, and I remember, she's like, I'm sorry. But I was just depressed. I was crying. I couldn't stop crying. The next morning, I get up, and I can't stop crying. That day, you know, as the time goes on, I start remembering, you know what? I didn't do my devotional yesterday. So let me go ahead and open it up and read the devotional I was supposed to yesterday. And as I open it, the first thing it says on the page is, not now. It said, not now, wait for the gift my father promised. And it's in the book of Acts. I knew that was a God wink. That was God speaking to me through that. And I was put an ease, and I knew I was loved, and I knew at that moment God had my back the whole time. Without a doubt, that was me being spoken to not to stop, not to give up, and not to quit. It was really because of that I kept going on. And if I didn't have that, I definitely wouldn't have that passion, but I know what I felt, and no one could take that away from me. And I know that the presence of God was there, and I felt just a big hug that everything was gonna be okay. My prayer was, at that point, coming back home, I was like, wow, I guess I'm gonna continue on this journey, but how am I gonna do it? How am I actually gonna do this? I have no trainer. I trained by myself. I trained with Bob. I was going school to schools, kind of trying to get the training in that I could. Most of the days I was training in my garage by myself with Bob, but I needed a coach to kind of tell me what I was doing, what I need to practice on, and to be there for me. In July of 2016, I get a message from a master instructor, and he's like, hi Victoria, you know, we've been watching your progress up until Rio, and we really hope that you're going to pursue Tokyo 2020. We're opening up a Taekwondo school in Houston starting this fall, and Master Youngin Bong is gonna be the head of the Olympic sparring program. When I read this, I was just like, is this for real? Like, I can't really believe this. But at the same time, I was just like, okay, well, yeah, I'm interested. Just kind of keep me in the loop and let me know when training is. And in the fall of 2016, I started working with Master Bong. And that was my coach for leading up to the Olympics 2020.
Hola, mi nombre es Young In Bang. Yo soy de Corea del Sur. Yo estuve 20 años en México. Yo gané como entrenador, mejor entrenador del mundo, 2014. Luego yo también gané el campeonato mundial de 2013, mejor entrenador del mundo también.
We all know Master Bong. How much perfect can this be? You know, you have the best, one of the best, if not the best coach in the world here in Houston for me to train under, and so many others.
Mi esposa quiere que yo esté en México, pero también mis hijas. Tengo que pensar mis hijas porque está creciendo. Por eso yo dejé todo. Okay, mis Juegos Olímpicos hasta 2016. No más Tokio, no más Los Ángeles, no más París. Yo pensaba algunos de chiquitos para preparar US Open, para National, para State, nada más. Pero ahora con Victoria otra vez, voy a ver si sexta vez Juegos Olímpicos. Para mí orgullo también, okay?
So training with him completely changed my game. I went from, you know, just like kind of this good level to like an high elite world class Olympic class level. From the very first day of training with him, I remember, I will never forget, after training, he comes up to me and he says it in Korean to his partner. And he asked his partner to ask me, why weren't you at the Rio Olympics? It just wasn't my time. And then he looks at me and says, Tokyo 2020, Tokyo 2020. That was the moment I knew, that is my coach right there. And that's all I needed, someone to believe in me for Tokyo 2020. Now I'm training with Master Bong. It's 2017. I'm doing amazing. Got the best female athlete in the Puerto Rico award. I started, you know, going to Grand Prix, doing well World Championships, all these things. And the next year, 2018, I tear my meniscus and I get my surgery. I come back, you know, 2 months later, and I'm back training and I'm doing my thing and I'm feeling pretty good. I go to Pan Am Games in 2019. And in the first fight, it was the second round, I was winning, but I do something to my knee and I go down. And when I went down, I knew exactly what I did because I know the feeling of what it is to tear a meniscus. I see Dr. Lowe, and sure enough, he checks it out and he's like, we're gonna have to do another meniscectomy. It was August 29th, 2019. I had my sixth knee surgery and it was the left knee. I woke up and I asked my dad how it went, and my dad tells me Dr. Lowe had to take out, I think it was 80 to 70% of your meniscus, so leaving you with 20 to 30% of your meniscus. And when he said that, I thought he was joking. I was really, 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 really sure that that was the end of my career.
You want to do everything you can to save the meniscus. But if it's not healable and causing mechanical symptoms, then just leaving it there can cause little areas of focal arthritic change that you really don't want. So it becomes a real bad guy in the knee. And so we can go transplant a new one and get a new meniscus there, but that's not really consistent with continuing competition at a really high level. So it does have an effect on the knee, and it can have a long-term effect on the knee that you just have to keep up with because there are solutions, but the healing time frames to do that really aren't consistent with coming back and playing at a high level in most circumstances.
Down days, you know, with any competitor, when they're competing, there's all sorts of issues, you know, through training that they're going to come across, and those were smaller of the speed bumps. I think the big one that we came across was when she realized how much of the meniscus they took out, because she was kind of fearful of the meniscus being removed because she was worried about down the line in the future having knee problems. She handled it well. She's very good at focusing on things that she can control, and what's out of her control she doesn't really stress about too much. So It was a day or two where she was, you know, kind of absorbing it all, but then after that we went straight back to work towards our goal of the qualifiers.
So at that moment, you know, I just kind of really surrendered everything.
She's probably one of the most driven people that I've known. She stayed motivated and to stay focused through all the trials and tribulations she had with injury. It's impressive.
Ahora, caso de Victoria está entrenando físico en la mañana con su propio entrenador, su personal entrenador. Ahora estoy cargando con ella más técnica, ¿no? Ahora está cerca de Juegos Olímpicos, entonces estoy viendo algunos videos, sus categorías, algunas competidoras de Europa, Asia, tanto África, también aquí zona América, ¿no? Entonces estoy viendo videos para agarrar timing, para tomar la distancia, qué tiene que hacer, qué vamos a pelear, algo así.
Now it's 2020. It's 2020, it's the beginning. I'm starting to get a little nervous and this knee surgery just happened 6 months ago and I know I'm not the same as I was, you know, before the surgery. I knew physically that I wasn't there yet. I knew I was gonna need more time for the healing process and everything that I just went through. Every single time I had that thought, I turned around and said, no, this is not my battle. This is on God. God is bringing me this far. I know this is on Him. So I totally surrendered the outcome. Whether I qualified or not, I was okay. With that mentality and with that mindset going in, and also learning to just be in the present and live in the present, that was the key that did it for me.
Antes de ir a Juegos Olímpicos, hablé con ella. Hey, Victoria, tú puedes ganar. Tenga confianza. Okay, tú puedes ganar, puedes estar triunfo en para Juegos Olímpicos. Entonces, antes de ir a ¿cómo se llama? Costa Rica, hablamos bien, luego agarramos la mano, un aplauso, así, ¿no? Un abrazo, le di mi energía de Juegos Olímpicos, algo así. Entonces, ella recibió mi energía, mis experiencias, todo. Entonces, ahí yo creo que peleó muy bien en Costa Rica.
So that was the beginning of all the COVID stuff happening. It was the favor of God. It was 100% the favor of God that day. The first fight I win, and you know, after that fight I was banged up. I was banged up, but I never once thought about what I was going through physically. I kept my eyes on God and I kept my eyes on just surrendering everything. I fight Canada next fight. She's a very good athlete, very good girl, very tall. And it was the last round, I landed a nice spinning kick, perfect timing, and I knew it was there the whole time. And there you go, I win that fight, you know, in the last round, it was a very close the whole time. The next fight in the finals, I was gonna have to fight the number one seed of the tournament, and she's a very good girl from Brazil, and she's very tall.
So I was there, I was beautiful. I wish I would've been closer, you know, my height, her being 5'3", 5'4", and she found a strategy. You know, she was rolling with the punches, rolling with the kicks, and made it work.
That fight, it was close. She hit me in the first round, like within the first 10 seconds to the face, and so I was like, oh shoot, all right, I gotta stay ready.
The crazy part about it was the last 5-10 seconds.
3-3, 5 seconds left. We get in the clinch.
You know, and snuck in that kick.
And boom, I hit it right in the inside, and then it 5-3 goes up. And I'm like, oh my goodness, that's it, that's it.
I was with her parents, her and her mom. We're hugging each other, crying, you know, couldn't hold back the tears.
I remember the crowd, you know, just going crazy. My parents just jumping up and down, and Juan, and then I just jump and hug my trainer.
She, you know, jumped over this little barrier, jumped on top of her coach, was so happy. They were both jumping up and down. It was one of the best moments of my life.
I'm like getting emotional just thinking about that second, and just knowing that's it, I just qualified for the Olympics. And it was just the most perfect moment ever. I was just so amazed, just keeping my faith. And his hand was over me and his favor was with me on that day. And that's how I was able to qualify. It really was. The next day after I qualify for the Olympics, the very next day, they cancel all the Taekwondo tournaments for the rest of the year. And so my tournament was the very last Taekwondo tournament before all the COVID shutdowns all across the world, everywhere. Changing my training around from training like two times a day to just training 1 hour a day, but smart and effective. I continued the same way all across of 2020. I did the same thing that I was doing leading up to the qualifiers. Now I've had that time in my body and my knee, I feel like it's normal. And here I am a year and a half later, and I haven't had, thank God, any issues. And so many things I had to deal with. But what's new? That's my life. That's been my life. That's been my journey. It's funny, you know, like I try and make all these plans for my life and God just says, no, we're not gonna do that. Sure enough, something like this happens and God surely just, I think, allows it to really have me just seek Him daily. So here I am, I'm still trying to make it and I'm going and I'm just trusting God and you know, whatever is gonna be, it's gonna be, and I'm totally surrendered, just like last year.
So we met at Urban Movement, which is a parkour group that I was a part of since I was a teenager, and it was closing down. And I wanted to keep going, and you know, Victoria had experience owning a school before, so it was almost like, you know, 1 + 1 = 2, like it just came together so well.
Started doing a lot of seminars all around the US and I started like really, really enjoying it. I was like, wow, I really love teaching. I really love sharing with the younger generation or even my generation, my passion and my love and being able to inspire anyone just a little bit in whatever way I could. And so opening up the gym has always been something that I wanted to do. I always had that in my mind. One day I want to open up my gym. I never thought it was going to be this soon in my life. I always thought it was going to be after the Olympics, but my fiance and our business partner, they were really ready for the parkour side. And I was like, well, I don't want to be left out. And you know, the Olympics got postponed. And so let's go ahead and open up the school this year.
We were just ready to make it happen. We were just kind of waiting. And then the Olympics were postponed and we started searching. You know, we had some extra time on our hands and found this location, beautiful location up in the Woodlands.
And everyone was on board. We opened up Believe, Commit, Achieve in September of 2020 during a pandemic.
So everything just came together at a great time. People were at the door since day one. You know, we had students like within the first couple days of opening. People were there, they just wanted to get out and have their kids do something, being locked in at home for so long. And we were that solution, teaching the kids how to express themselves in a disciplined way. For both require a lot of discipline, Taekwondo and parkour. You don't just go out like an adrenaline junkie, right? You have a lot of discipline. I'm learning your techniques, learning your form, and yeah, we love doing it.
So this journey has also been a walk, just like complete walk of faith in God, because we were able to find this amazing location. And then on top of that, I had a friend who, that I trained his son. He donated this spring floor that we're sitting on. More things were happening with the parkour equipment, almost for free, basically, with everything that they got. It was a really good deal, and just everything started coming together. A lot of volunteers just helping us, fixing up the school and paint and put things up the way they are. And then to top it off, we have the most amazing company, Century, who just comes in and just, you know, helps us with these amazing bags that we have back here and sends us those and then helps sponsor with so many other things that I'm doing here at the school. I just truly knew it was like God's favor in this whole process and knowing like, okay, I think, you know, we're doing something that God wants us to do here because He's supplying all our needs.
We actually went to our first tournament as BCA and I got to see them compete as a team and I just kind of fantasized this amazing journey of, you know, their first tournament to like our Olympian that comes out of this location. I just love seeing that journey from square one, you know, that slow, patient, persistent, step-by-step process, you know, through parkour, through Taekwondo. And we want to find ways to integrate them as well because they complement each other really nicely.
That's really what I've been holding on to. It's evident to see God's work in here.
We have big dreams. Obviously, Victoria's going to the Olympics. There's no equivalent Olympic path for parkour. It's a newer sport, so we would be pioneering that path for parkour, being inspired by Taekwondo, which is more established, obviously, having an Olympic path with it. So just want to kind of combine those two things together.
Our old school used to go to, we went to a seminar and Master Victoria was there, and she's also pretty well known in the Taekwondo community. So we moved to Texas about a few months ago, and we knew Ms. Victoria for a while, right? So we knew she opened a school, so we wanted to see it out, check it out, and we thought it was pretty good.
She's always so amazing, she's always so sweet, but she's also very fierce, and I admire that.
You know, she helps us with our positives, and she helps us with our negatives. Like, she takes the time out of her day to help us be the greatest we can, so.
At school, I am a very, very nervous and kind of awkward person, but when I came here, I learned how to actually speak to people and I learned how to be more confident.
I love just making relations with the kids and any student. I really love encouraging. I know martial arts, and traditionally, it can be a little harsh. And what I've known to see, especially in Taekwondo, where the master instructors, not mine, but a lot of master instructors, you know, are too proud to tell their student, good job. Are too proud to tell their student, wow, you're a good athlete. Are like, you're good. And that's what I absolutely didn't want. I wanted the kids to feel loved. I wanted them to feel encouraged. And not to be lied to, but the honest truth, like, that was a really great kick. Like, keep it up. And that's what I want to be. I want to be just a bundle of love that the kids can see, and also an example of perseverance. Someone who trusts God and puts their faith completely in Christ. And that's one of the best things I think about teaching. What we do here in Believe, Commit, Achieve, it's really that Proverbs 16:3 verse that I think has been my go-to throughout my life. Commit to the Lord in whatever you do, and your plans will succeed.